On May the 13th, 1943, the British Prime Minister Winston Churchill received a communication from one of his most senior commanders. The message was simple, direct, and very welcome. "Sir, it is my duty to report that the Tunisian campaign is over. All enemy resistance has ceased. We are the masters of the North African shores." The news could hardly have been better. Britain and her allies had won a strategic victory, and Churchill was delighted. The way was now clear for an assault against the European heartlands of the enemy. The message from North Africa signaled the end of a six-month campaign that began in the aftermath of the Battle of El Alamein. But even as the fighting raged in the deserts of Egypt, the British commander Bernard Montgomery knew that the Allied presence in North Africa was about to be reinforced. After the victory at Alamein, Montgomery's 8th Army began a pursuit of the Panzer Armee Africa, led by Field Marshal Erwin Rommel. At the same time, a huge Allied fleet prepared to land a second Allied army on African shores. In the early days of November 1942, the largest amphibious landing force in history made final preparations off the coasts of Northwest Africa. Its ultimate destination, the Vichy France colony of Tunisia. This was a combined army. For the first time in the Second World War, troops from the United States joined with their colleagues from Great Britain in a bold attempt to push the enemy out of North Africa for good. On the map, the objective looked straightforward. As Montgomery's 8th Army pushed the Axis westwards from Egypt, the new 1st Army would advance from the other side to squeeze the German and Italian presence until their resistance was broken. On the 13th of May 1943, the Allied leadership knew that their plan had succeeded, and victory in North Africa was theirs. It was one of the most memorable campaigns of the whole war, involving famous commanders and legendary weapons. Soldiers of both sides displayed great courage in a harsh physical environment that tested the endurance of the strongest men. This was the campaign that took place on the battlefield of Tunisia. It was an Allied victory whose story began at a time when it was the Axis who seemed irresistible. In June 1940, Adolf Hitler basked in his own glory as he celebrated the greatest victory of his German armed forces. The Führer's presence in Paris confirmed the German conquest of continental Western Europe. Hitler had finally avenged his country's defeat in the First World War a generation before. He was now the master of France. But the German Reich chose not to occupy the whole of the country. In the south, a new France was established, a rump state, with its capital at Vichy. Though Vichy France was officially independent, under the leadership of the aging Philippe Pétain, her room for maneuver was limited. The new state could not risk upsetting Germany. Everyone knew what was likely to happen if it did. But Vichy France did have one significant responsibility. She was left in charge of French colonies in North Africa, at a time when European influence in the region was strong. In the west, France controlled the territories of Morocco, Algeria, and Tunisia. To the east, Egypt lay within the British sphere of influence. Libya was under the authority of Mussolini's Italy. It was here, in September 1940, that 44 months of armed conflict began. This was the Desert War that came to its final conclusion in Tunisia. In June 1940, the Italian leader Mussolini decided to bring his nation into the action of the Second World War. With France on the point of defeat, Mussolini thought he could take advantage of the situation by launching his own invasion of southern France. Il Duce wanted some glory of his own. What he got was an embarrassing defeat. His invasion force was defeated by a French army of inferior numbers. But Mussolini did not lose his ambition for conquest. 3 months later, he launched another military enterprise, an attack on Egypt by his powerful Libyan army. This time, the result was even more humiliating for the Italian leader. The reasoning behind the invasion can be seen on a 1940 map of the North Africa region. At the time, Italy was already dominant in Libya. To the southeast, Abyssinia was also an Italian possession. Mussolini's plan was to connect his two colonies, beginning with the conquest of Egypt. It seemed like a straightforward task. The Italian army in Libya numbered 300,000. In neighboring Egypt, the British Western Desert Force of Major General Richard O'Connor numbered 30,000. The British were outnumbered 10 to 1, but it was the Italians who soon found themselves on a costly retreat after their offensive began in September 1940. After an initial advance of some 60 miles into Egypt, the British struck back in December. Within days, the Italians were in flight. By February 7, 1941, the British had captured no less than 130,000 enemy troops in the course of a remarkable counter-offensive. By the time Churchill decided to direct his regional resources to the fighting in Greece, the British had also taken a huge chunk of African territory. When the British leader called a halt to the advance, Britain had captured the whole of eastern Libya. It was a humiliation for Italy, and their German allies were not prepared to let the situation rest. In February 1941, Hitler dispatched one of his most gifted soldiers to the city of Tripoli in western Libya. General Erwin Rommel was given command of a new German presence in the region, the Africa Corps. The British were to find Rommel a far more vigorous adversary. In the months that followed Rommel's arrival, the Germans proved themselves far more effective soldiers than their Italian allies. 1941 saw the Africa Corps push the British back, recapturing virtually all of the territory lost by the Italians. The city of Tobruk was besieged for 8 months, and the hardships endured by the Allied men trapped there became the stuff of legend. But the second half of 1941 saw the besiegers dominant in the desert fighting. Only when Rommel overreached himself in an ambitious dash to the Egyptian border could the British mount an effective counterattack. On December 10, 1941, the siege of Tobruk was lifted as Rommel led his men back across Libyan territory. The liberation of Tobruk seemed like a great achievement at the time. Church bells rang out across Britain to celebrate a first victory over German ground forces. But in early 1942, the enemy commander in Africa hit back in style. The Axis retreat from Tobruk was well organized and deliberate, and Rommel was soon back on the offensive. At the age of 50, Erwin Rommel was now the youngest field marshal in the Wehrmacht. He had also acquired the nickname Desert Fox, and the first half of 1942 confirmed his growing status as a commander of guile and cunning. From January to July, Rommel led his new Panzerarmee Africa on a relentless advance across northern Libya. At Gizala, he overcame a considerable Allied defense with a combination of tactical ingenuity and battlefield flexibility. His clever deployment of armor and artillery proved especially valuable as the British-led 8th Army struggled to respond. By the 13th of June, the British commanders were forced to order a retreat, and there was worse to come. At Gizala, the British leadership was ineffective. When Rommel sought to recapture the port of Tobruk, his opposing commanders proved little better than incompetent. Poor intelligence, combined with panic-stricken leadership, resulted in a British loss of huge symbolic significance. A week after the defeat at Gizala, the British had also conceded Tobruk, a turn of events that many in London found hard to take. Still, the Panzer Army swept forward, crossing the Libyan border into Egypt itself. The Allied presence in North Africa was now in real danger. The city of Cairo flew into a panic as the retreating British established a new defensive line just 60 miles west of the Egyptian capital. But the position was well chosen, stretching south from the settlement of El Alamein to the impassable Katara Depression in the south. An outflanking maneuver was out of the question. Despite the best efforts of the Axis forces under Rommel's command, the British line held against a series of direct assaults in July 1942. By the end of the month, two exhausted armies paused to regroup as the British leadership considered their next move. The British commander in Egypt was General Claude Auchinleck. Following the disaster at Tobruk, he took personal charge of the 8th Army, in addition to his duties as commander-in-chief of the Middle East region. It was Auchinleck's decision to form his defense at El Alamein that finally halted Rommel's great advance across North Africa. But back in London, Churchill was deeply concerned with events in Africa, and in early August, he visited the front himself, with changes very much in his mind. In early August, Churchill decided to place his African forces under new leadership. Lieutenant General Bernard Montgomery was appointed as the new commander of the 8th Army, under the overall regional command of General Sir Harold Alexander. These were the men on whom the Allies would depend when fighting resumed in the Egyptian desert. Though Montgomery had no experience of the desert fighting, he was quick to prove himself a master of the African battlefield. In early September, his men succeeded in thwarting a final attempt by Rommel to break through the 8th Army line at Amel Halfa. The British commander could be well pleased with his achievement. Less than 3 weeks after arriving in Africa, Bernard Montgomery had defeated the Desert Fox, and an army that had been in poor shape when he arrived began to recover its fighting spirit. Now its commander was to consider his own next move in Egypt. By early October, Montgomery had decided to launch an offensive of his own. But back in London, the British leadership had already been involved in decisions concerning much wider regional objectives in the lands of Northern Africa. In the early months of 1942, the British leadership engaged in an ongoing debate with their counterparts in the United States. As soon as America entered the war in December 1941, the question of how best to deploy her resources became a matter for serious consideration. At the time, the German army was engaged in a ferocious campaign deep inside the frontiers of the Soviet Union. If the British and Americans could draw Hitler's attention elsewhere, the pressure on Stalin and the Russians would be eased. In early 1942, the Western Allies were keen to open this second front. The only question was where. In Washington, many leading figures in the General Staff argued for an assault against Western Europe. But the British maintained that even with American support, the success of a continental invasion could not be guaranteed. The American industrial machine was not yet fully geared up for war production, and so the idea of an invasion of Africa began to gain favor. When Rommel launched his summer offensive against the 8th Army in Libya, the argument for such an enterprise grew compelling as the British retreated into Egypt. By the time General Auchinleck halted the German advance near El Alamein, the American president was all but convinced. Roosevelt was determined to deploy his armed forces against the European Axis powers, and when no agreement could be reached for an attack against the continent, he accepted the British idea of an operation in North Africa. It was decided that instead of joining the British in Egypt, a new American force should be sent to the other side of the North African region. By the end of July 1942, the Western Allies agreed that a huge amphibious force should be landed in the region. For the first time in the Second World War, American and British forces would join together in action against the Axis powers. 107,000 troops were allocated for the landings, an enterprise that marked the beginning of the Tunisia campaign. It was given the codename Operation Torch. On the 26th of July, 1942, President Roosevelt appointed the commander to take overall charge of Operation Torch. Lieutenant General Dwight D. Eisenhower had never engaged in active combat, but he had established a name for himself in the planning department of the Washington staff. And he quickly added to his reputation as the detailed planning for Operation Torch began. In the weeks that followed Eisenhower's appointment, transatlantic discussions between the British and Americans considered issues such as landing sites, timetables, and troop dispositions. The arguments were often heated, though all were united on the strategic objective of the task ahead. The plan was to capture the territories of Morocco, Algeria, and Tunisia, and expose what became known as the soft underbelly of the enemy. Sicily, and then Italy. But the political situation in North Africa presented the Allies with a serious problem. Morocco, Algeria, and Tunisia were all under the control of Vichy France. No fewer than 100,000 troops were stationed on the ground, and the Allies could not be sure how their commanders would react in the event of an invasion. Part of the problem was an anti-British feeling that characterized Vichy France as a whole. Many French leaders could not forgive Britain for sinking her North African fleet at Oran in 1940. But it had never broken off contact with the United States, so the Allies decided that Operation Torch should appear to be as American as possible. For this reason, the late summer of 1942 saw American attempts to find a French leader with sufficient authority to persuade the local North African commanders to support the Allied landings. One high-profile figure considered inappropriate was General Charles de Gaulle, the leader of the London-based Free French. Another option was Lieutenant General Henri Giraud. A war hero and former prisoner, Giraud escaped from German captivity and returned to Vichy France, where he was allowed to live freely, although under surveillance. By the time the planning for Operation Torch was completed, it was intended that Giraud be smuggled out of France and taken to North Africa in the Allied cause. If he could persuade his fellow Frenchmen to back the Americans and British, the potential advantages were obvious. But the Allied desire to keep Operation Torch as secret as possible meant that Giraud was not informed of the full picture. This remained the case even after the Allies had identified him as the most likely figure to drum up support for the Allied invasion. But the French general must have suspected that something big was about to happen when he was secretly picked up on the Mediterranean coast and taken to Gibraltar on a British submarine. Only then, on November the 7th, was he told that Operation Torch would begin in a matter of hours. Until then, he knew nothing of the details of the Allied assault. He was not the only one. The arrival of three huge task forces would also come as a surprise to the French commanders on the ground in North Africa. The ambitious objectives of Operation Torch can be identified on the North African map. On the coasts of Morocco, the Western Task Force of General George S. Patton were given the task of capturing the port of Casablanca. Their landings would be made after a sea voyage from bases on the east coast of the United States. For the capture of Algeria, two further task forces were required, both of them sailing from bases in the United Kingdom. The Central Task Force of General Fredenhall was detailed to capture the region around the port of Oran, while the Eastern Task Force of General Ryder intended to move against the Algerian capital of Algiers. All commanders knew of the possibility of French resistance. Their hope was that Giraud and others could minimize its impact. It was possible that the capture of Algeria and Morocco could be an expensive enterprise, and these were only the first objectives of Operation Torch. As soon as the landings had been made successfully, the Allies intended to form a new First Army to advance eastwards towards Tunisia. The presence of Axis air power in Sicily and southern Italy meant that this final objective would have to be achieved by a ground operation, and it was likely that an Allied army already in Africa would be involved. On the 7th of November 1942, Eisenhower and his colleagues made final preparations for the launch of Operation Torch from their base in Gibraltar. And they knew that the strategic situation in North Africa had already altered in the most dramatic manner as a result of events in faraway Egypt. There, a massive and historic engagement had just concluded, a battle between two great armies who would also play a key role in the fighting for Tunisia. On the 23rd of October 1942, at 21:40 hours, a huge artillery barrage shattered the silence of the Egyptian desert. It was an Allied attack, a ferocious 15-minute onslaught that marked the beginning of the Battle of El Alamein. 20 minutes later, the engineers and infantrymen of Montgomery's 8th Army advanced into a formidable German defensive line. Their job was to clear the way for the armored units that would play the decisive role in the battle to come. For the first time, the British Desert Forces were able to engage the Panzerarmee Afrika with a real sense of confidence. In the preceding months, the 8th Army took delivery of substantial reinforcements of men and material. Powerful American Sherman tanks now proved themselves on the African battlefield, and Montgomery enjoyed an overall advantage in resources of approximately 2-1. The efforts of Allied codebreakers also meant that Montgomery enjoyed superior intelligence. The 8th Army commander knew that when he launched his attack on October the 23rd, his great rival Rommel was nowhere near the battlefield. Instead, he was ill with jaundice on sick leave in Austria. Montgomery also succeeded in keeping his own intentions secret. By using effective camouflage and by deploying a dummy army to the south of his line, Montgomery fooled the enemy into thinking his attack would come from this direction. Instead, his main assault force intended to break through nearer the coast. When the 8th Army launched their attack with a huge artillery barrage on the evening of October the 23rd, Montgomery had achieved full tactical surprise. His opponent was soon out of his sickbed and flying back to the desert. But not even the great Rommel could beat the odds that faced him at the Battle of El Alamein. However, it took 12 days of bitter fighting before the 8th Army broke through his line, and the reputation of the Desert Fox remained intact. Even with Rommel absent, the Germans and Italians put up a stiff resistance to Montgomery's attack. Early in the battle, the main British armored division found itself bogged down on what was an insignificant ridge in the desert landscape. But the two sides fought for this ridge as if it was the most valuable plot of land on earth. 88mm German guns pounded the British armor. The Axis positions found themselves assaulted from the air. Many German panzers fell victim to the 40mm cannon of the British Hurricane 2D. When Rommel returned to the battlefield, he found a scene of devastation and destruction, but his line still held. And on the fourth day of fighting, he unleashed no fewer than 5 counterattacks with his remaining armored resources. On a day of bloody combat, all of them were repulsed, but still the 8th Army could make the breakthrough into the open desert as the battlefield shook with the force of war. Montgomery was forced to pause and reorganize his resources to make the decisive breakthrough, as all the time his material advantage increased. On November the 4th, 1942, the leading British armoured divisions smashed their way into the open desert, and the Battle of El Alamein was over. But the North African war continued. By the time the British tanks broke through at El Alamein, the crafty Rommel was already retreating, and he was able to continue his retreat in good order towards Tunisia as the British took up the chase. In the end, Rommel was able to save what was left of his Panzer Armee Africa to fight another day. Many have argued that his great rival Montgomery was too cautious in his pursuit, but the British commander knew something that Rommel didn't. As the Desert Fox began his retreat, three Allied fleets were forming into position around the coasts to the northwest of the African landmass. Montgomery knew that Operation Torch was about to begin. Before long, he and Rommel would meet again in combat. But they were not the only great leaders who displayed their skills on the battlefield of Tunisia. Of all the commanders who saw service in the Second World War, perhaps none achieved the worldwide fame of General Dwight D. Eisenhower. It's unlikely that the man universally known as Ike would have become President of the United States in 1953 if it had not been for his military exploits in the previous decade. But when Lieutenant General Eisenhower was appointed to command the torch landings in July 1942, it was a decision that came as a surprise to many. At the time, he was 51 years of age, but he had never taken a command post in battle. During the First World War, Eisenhower was responsible for a tank corps training center. In the years that followed, he worked in the Command and General Staff School before his appointment as Chief of Staff to the 3rd U.S. Army in 1941. Throughout this period, Eisenhower impressed his superiors with his charm and administrative skill, and it was this that led Roosevelt to appoint him commander of U.S. forces in Europe in June 1942. The fighting in North Africa gave Eisenhower his first chance to demonstrate his abilities in the field. By May 1943, he'd proved himself a leader in battle, and subsequent postings in Sicily, Italy, and especially Northwest Europe only added to his fame. By the time the fighting in Tunisia came to an end, his most senior British subordinate had also established his reputation. In contrast to Eisenhower, General Sir Harold Alexander was well acquainted with field operations by the time of the Tunisia campaign. Born in 1891, Alexander served with distinction as an officer during the grim fighting of World War I. By the time war broke out again in 1939, Alexander had attained the rank of Major General, and he was given a divisional command in the British Expeditionary Force sent to France. It was the beginning of a brilliant war. At Dunkirk, Harold Alexander was responsible for the amazing evacuation of the British Army almost from under the noses of the Germans. A senior command in the jungles of Burma followed, before Churchill appointed him Commander-in-Chief of British Middle East Forces in August 1942. As such, he was in overall charge of the great victory at El Alamein. And his remarkable career did not end in Egypt. By the end of the Battle of Tunisia, General Alexander was commander of the Allied 18th Army Group, and answerable only to Eisenhower. Like his American superior, Alexander also went on to serve in Sicily and Italy before a successful political career after the war. But it's for his leadership in Africa that Alexander is best remembered. Much of Alexander's reputation derived from his excellent working relationship with his own subordinate in Africa, Lieutenant General Bernard Montgomery. The two men got on extremely well, perhaps in part because of the similarity of their military careers. 3 years older than Alexander, Montgomery also served with distinction during the Great War. Like Alexander, Montgomery took charge of a division within the British Expeditionary Force in 1939. After excelling himself at Dunkirk, his next big appointment came in the summer of 1942, when he was given command of the 8th Army in Egypt. He had now acquired the nickname Monty, and he cut a distinctive figure with his trademark two-badge beret. He was already one of the most recognisable faces in the British Army. After the victory at El Alamein, he became one of the best-known faces of his nation. Montgomery ended the war as a field marshal and commander-in-chief of British armies on the Western European front. Known as a cautious commander, the only blight on his magnificent service record came when he proposed the one genuinely radical operation of his career, the failed attempt to capture the bridge at Arnhem in September 1944. But his achievements elsewhere were substantial, and like his superior Alexander, Montgomery took a post-war title that reflected his achievements in North Africa, Viscount Montgomery of El Alamein. Despite Montgomery's trademark tactical caution, he was one of the great showmen of the British Army and a great inspiration to his men. But in November 1942, he was not the only great showman fighting for the Allies in North Africa. In charge of the westernmost sector of the torch landings was an American commander who could never be accused of caution, George S. Patton. Operation Torch marked the debut of American forces against the Axis powers in Europe, and George Patton was determined to seize the limelight. But it was not until March 1943 that he was able to get into the thick of the action as commander of the American Second Corps. But when he did, he made an immediate impact, reinforcing the morale and the discipline of a body of troops who'd suffered from poor leadership in the face of concerted enemy activity. Known for his industrial language, Patton's aggression could lead to difficulties. During the 1943 campaign in Sicily, the American general physically attacked two shell-shocked men who he believed to be guilty of cowardice. Patton was withdrawn from frontline duties, but his skills as a soldier were too good to ignore. In 1944, he sealed his reputation for boldness as commander of the US Third Army that finally broke out of the Normandy bridgehead. His death in a traffic accident in 1945 was a great loss to the American Army and the American nation. Patton's aggressive nature was not restricted to his subordinates. He was more than capable of fierce exchanges with his fellow commanders, and there were times when his relationship with his fellow showman Montgomery was tense. Fortunately for the Allies, Eisenhower's diplomatic skills kept any tensions in check during the Tunisia campaign. Their enemy was not so fortunate. When Operation Torch began on the 8th of November 1942, its ultimate objective was Tunisia, a country without any Axis troops in residence. But the Allies could be all but certain that the enemy leadership would move quickly to alter the situation, and they were proved right. In a matter of weeks, the 5th German Panzer Army was established on Tunisian soil, and on December the 9th, 1942, its command was given to Colonel General Hans-Jürgen von Armin. At the age of 53, von Armin had already enjoyed a distinguished military career. In June 1941, he impressed his political leaders with his skills as a panzer commander during the invasion of Russia. Though he was wounded early in the conflict, he was never forgotten, and he was the ideal choice for command of the new army established in Tunisia in response to Operation Torch. Like his British counterpart, Montgomery, von Armin was an instantly recognizable figure, with his immaculate jackboots and studious monocle. Von Armin also shared an instinct for caution with his British rival, an instinct that marked him out from his most famous colleague during the Battle of Tunisia. Field Marshal Erwin Rommel has always been one of the best remembered figures of the Second World War. A charismatic soldier with a strong personal presence, Rommel's active service career began on the battlefields of the First World War, where he earned Germany's highest award for bravery. By the start of World War II, he'd risen to the rank of Major General, and his legend was already beginning to form. In 1940, as commander of the 7th Panzer Division, Rommel led a devastating German advance to the coast of the English Channel, earning a Knight's Cross in the process. 1941 was another year of glory. Appointed commander of the new Africa Corps in February, by December, he was the youngest field marshal in the German army. Rommel liked to think of himself as possessing the cunning nature of the fox. Almost as soon as he arrived in Africa, he acquired the nickname by which he's still known today, the Desert Fox. Time and again, Rommel was able to seize the initiative with tactical surprise, and his troops recognized the special talents of their battlefield commander. Rommel was almost worshipped by the men under his command. To talk of a cult of Rommel in the German ranks would not be an exaggeration, and this powerful admiration even extended to the general's enemies. When Montgomery first arrived in Africa, he found many of his own men obsessed with Rommel, always wondering what the great Desert Fox was going to do next. Monty's first task in Africa was to persuade his troops that they too could achieve great victories. But admiration for Rommel did not extend to his colleague, Hans-Jürgen von Armen. Unfortunately for the Axis cause, the two German commanders possessed a strong dislike for each other. On at least one occasion, Axis momentum in Tunisia was lost because of arguments between the two men. Rommel thought von Armen to be too cautious. Von Armen thought the opposite of Rommel. The Desert Fox also argued with his superiors, but his opinions were not always so enthusiastic when it came to his colleagues. The structure of the Axis command in North Africa meant that the Desert Fox was formally answerable to the commander-in-chief of all German forces in the Mediterranean region, Albert Kesselring. Born in 1889, Albert Kesselring first trained as a gunner. But by the end of World War I, he enjoyed a position within Imperial Germany's general staff. In the 1930s, he joined the young Luftwaffe, and in 1939, he was a Luftflotte commander during the invasion of Poland. Kesselring also took part in the Battle of Britain, and despite the German defeat, his career continued to advance with his appointment as German Commander-in-Chief South. Later on in the war, Kesselring secured his reputation as a leader with his imaginative defense of the Italian peninsula. But in Africa, his contribution was perhaps less impressive. Rommel argued with Kesselring repeatedly, believing that his superior was not prepared to commit sufficient air power to the North African theater. This was just one of the many disputes within the Axis leadership during the Tunisian campaign, and Hitler himself was often involved in the arguments. There is no doubt that the Allies enjoyed a smoother command of the resources that they brought to the Tunisia battlefield. The American entry into the war against the European Axis powers could hardly have been more dramatic. The final plan for Operation Torch called for an amphibious landing of 107,000 men under arms. 84,000 were Americans, the rest British. The plans also allowed for reinforcements to arrive once the campaign on the ground was underway. These new forces were in addition to the existing Allied presence in Africa. As the Torch landings began, Montgomery's 8th Army was advancing through Libya towards Tunisia. This was an international force, with units drawn from Australia, New Zealand, South Africa, and India backing up the British. In the aftermath of El Alamein, Montgomery could call on the manpower of 180,000 troops. When the fighting for Tunisia reached its final stages, the Allied presence in Africa totaled some 380,000 men. It was a total that their enemies could only wish for. In early November 1942, the Axis presence in Tunisia was nil. But as soon as the news of the Torch landings came through, the German and Italian leaderships moved quickly to establish a ground force to resist the Allied offensive. Just days after the first Allied troops stepped ashore, the Axis command announced the creation of the new 5th Panzer Army, based in Tunisia. By the end of November, 15,500 new German and Italian troops had arrived in North Africa. A month later, General von Armen could call on the resources of 65,000 men, of whom 47,000 were German. The Panzerarmee Afrika of Erwin Rommel was also part of the picture. Despite heavy losses at El Alamein, the Desert Fox still commanded a force of 54,000, and Axis reinforcements continued to arrive in Africa until the last weeks of the Tunisia campaign. But it was the Allies who enjoyed the numerical superiority by the time the fighting in Tunisia neared its end. For the final battles, the Axis presence in Tunisia totaled 175,000 against an Allied presence more than twice the size. The Allies also enjoyed a substantial advantage in all forms of military material. But the fighting in Tunisia saw both sides deploy some of the finest weapons seen in any theater of the Second World War. Fighting in North Africa revealed a number of similarities with other theatres of operations during World War II. The importance of the tank for successful offensive warfare was as relevant in North Africa as it was in Russia or the Western Front. At El Alamein, the newly arrived American Sherman tanks made a big difference to Allied success, and the powerful Shermans had a key role to play in the battles for Tunisia. But the Allies were also able to call on other excellent machines as the Tunisia offensive unfolded. Towards the end of the campaign, the first consignment of Mark IV Churchill tanks arrived in the theatre. Early models of the Churchill were known for their heavy armour and relative lack of speed, and the Mark IV continued in the tradition. What made the Mark IV different was its impressive main gun. At El Alamein, the Shermans had proved the value of a 75mm calibre weapon. The Mark IV Churchill was similarly armed, and despite its lack of speed, the Mark IV proved to have excellent mobility in hilly conditions, something that could be well appreciated in the sloping terrain that defined much of the Tunisian landscape. But the Tunisian battles were not restricted to the ground. All through the Desert War, air power was generously deployed. At El Alamein, the Allied superiority in the air made a huge contribution to victory, with the ground attack Hurricane 2D playing an especially important role. The Hawker Hurricane 2D was designed specifically as an anti-tank weapon. An earlier model had proved itself during the Battle of Britain. For its duties in North Africa, the Hurricane's design was modified. The big difference with the Type 2D was its armament. Other versions of the Hurricane were fitted with 12 machine guns or 4 20mm cannon. The 2D used at Alamein was armed with two weapons of 40mm caliber. This was more than enough to open up a panzer at the time of the Tunisia campaign. The 2D was sometimes known as the Tank Buster, but its firepower meant that it also gained another nickname, the Tin Opener. In Tunisia, the German armored units could understand why. Neutralizing the impact of the panzers was a vital objective for the Allied commanders in Tunisia. In many engagements, the traditional 6-pound anti-tank gun proved more than enough to deal with the German armor. But a new generation of German tanks was now coming into commission, with heavier armor up to 110 millimeters thick. Fortunately for the Allies, they were able to respond with a new weapon of their own, the British 17-pound anti-tank gun. In late 1942, the first hurriedly prepared 17-pounders arrived in Africa as a direct response to the new generation of heavy panzers. In early 1943, the new guns made their battlefield debut when Rommel launched his final offensive on the African continent. Their impact was devastating. The 76.2mm shells could penetrate armour to a thickness of 130 millimetres. And there was nothing that any panzer crew could do against a direct hit within a 1 kilometer range. For closer engagements, the Allies relied on another memorable weapon to cause maximum damage to the German armored units. Early in 1942, the American Army took delivery of its first batch of handheld anti-tank weapons, the bazookas. For the first time in battle, the individual infantryman could make an impact against a tank. He had to be close to the target. The M1 bazooka's maximum effective range was only 130 yards. Armed with a weapon that could penetrate 80 millimeters of armor, the bazooka soldier could make a devastating impact in armoured engagements. It was little short of a revolution in warfare. But in Tunisia, there were some German tanks against whose armour the bazooka could make little impact. At El Alamein, the Type 4 German panzers that had previously seemed invincible found themselves outgunned. On the ground, the American-built Sherman proved to be the superior machine. The Type 4 was also vulnerable against air attack from the Hurricanes. But its 75mm gun was still a force to be reckoned with, and the Type 4 contributed to every armoured offensive launched by von Armin and Rommel during the Tunisian fighting. But what both German commanders really wanted was the new Type 6 panzer, the Tiger. At El Alamein, Rommel was promised delivery of a consignment of these monster vehicles. None arrived. But in late 1942, von Armin did receive a delivery of Tigers. His relief was understandable. Defensively and offensively, the Type 6 represented a great leap forward in tank design. Its armour had a maximum thickness of 110mm. The calibre of its gun was a massive 88mm. Inevitably, it was a heavy machine. Its 56-ton weight meant that speed was sacrificed. For this reason, the Tigers were never deployed at divisional levels. But smaller Tiger units could make a devastating impact in battle, and a direct hit meant only one fate for the crews of a more lightly protected Allied tank. But of all the German weapons used in the Tunisia fighting, it may be that one was remembered most by the Allied men who witnessed it in action. Early in the war, the German military machine came up with the idea of the Nebelwerfer, or smoke thrower. This was a rocket launcher designed to create a tactical smoke screen on the battlefield. But it soon became clear that the 15-centimetre artillery rockets could also be used to fire explosive shells. The result was a towed weapon with six launching tubes, each capable of firing a 75-pound shell to a range of 1.5 miles. In Tunisia, the Nebelwerfer proved especially valuable against narrow Allied defensive positions. But it wasn't just the firepower that Allied soldiers recalled long after the war. It was the unsettling noise that the shells made in flight. The Nebelwerfer shells were quickly given the nickname Moaning Minis. Allied reaction was an understandable mixture of fear and admiration for a highly advanced weapon of its day. But as well as the latest in weapon design, the German forces in North Africa were also able to deploy machines that had already proved themselves in all theatres of World War II. The Messerschmitt Bf 109 was a classic example. First used in the Spanish Civil War, the Bf 109 was the most famous of all German single-seat fighters during World War II. In the early months of the war, the 109 proved itself to be a devastating element of Hitler's blitzkrieg, though it struggled in the Battle of Britain against the more manoeuvrable Spitfires and Hurricanes. But it remained in service, and in Tunisia, the Bf 109 found a new lease of life as a low-flying warplane with impressive firepower. The Model G was typically armed with two 13mm and three 30mm cannon. Flying low, the 109 could make a serious impact on ground positions, and Allied troops found that it could fly so low that their own 40mm anti-aircraft guns were ineffective. So it was with a combination of old and new hardware that the Axis forces squared up to the Allied Tunisia offensive, an operation that was about to begin in early November 1942. On the evening of November the 7th, 1942, the Allies stood on the verge of launching the biggest amphibious landing in history. Off the coast of Morocco, the Western Task Force had sailed from the American East Coast and taken up position for an assault on Casablanca. In the Mediterranean, troops of the Central and Eastern Task Forces made ready for attacks on the ports of Iran and Algiers. At his Gibraltar headquarters, Eisenhower knew that his preparations were complete. The time for battle had arrived. Operation Torch would be just the first stage in the hard task of clearing the Axis forces from North Africa. The Allied commander could be confident in the men and materials under his command. But in war, there are always uncertainties. Eisenhower could not be sure how the local French troops would react to the invasion. He did not know how quickly the Axis would build up a presence in Tunisia. Far away in Libya, the charismatic figure of Rommel still led a substantial military force towards the border with Tunisia. There was also the reality that Operation Torch was the first time that American and British troops were joined in a single army. But Eisenhower could be sure that one way or another, a memorable campaign was about to begin. It would involve 6 months of fighting on the battlefield of Tunisia.